This is Fair TV. I'm Peter Hart. The corporate media's panicky coverage of the Ebola crisis has spilled over into some discussions about the state of Washington politics. One angle has been the fact that the United States doesn't currently have a Surgeon General, a person who presumably could be a high-profile voice of reason at a moment like this. So what's the problem?
Tell me what this is all about, because I know this is a story that has about 9 different sides to it here.
Well, I mean, this is the other epidemic in Washington, the epidemic that you talked about, the inability to get anything done. It is rampant here, but this particular example had to do with, of all things, gun control and the statements that the nominee had made about gun control. So it's gotten wrapped up in that issue, which seems wholly unrelated. It's just one of a long list of appointments that haven't been approved by a Senate that just doesn't work very well.
Senator Casey, why don't we have a Surgeon General confirmed? Dr. Vivek Murthy was nominated over a year ago.
It's Washington dysfunction, Chuck. It's as simple as that.
But this story deserves a better explanation than that. Congress doesn't work is just part of the problem. Chuck Todd, to his credit, did a better job of explaining this than his politician guests. Barack Obama's nominee to be Surgeon General, Vivek Murthy, does indeed have a problem. That problem is the National Rifle Association. Murthy has spoken out about gun violence as a public health issue. The NRA doesn't like that, and they let lawmakers know. Republicans have more or less uniformly spoken out against him, and a few Democrats have joined them. A media that actually sought to explain Washington would make this very clear then. But there's also a larger point here. For all this talk of dysfunction, maybe it's time to drop that frame altogether. Clearly, Washington is working perfectly well for certain special interest groups. This recent Time cover isn't exactly subtle. If you thought the article inside the magazine might be flattering to Republican Senator Ron Paul, you'd be correct. The piece tells us that Paul's positions on the issues can be complicated, in a good way, but this means that he's often misunderstood. And other times, though, it's just his enemies attacking him. That's what Time says happened back in 2010, when Paul made headlines, after an interview with MSNBC's Rachel Maddow in which Paul tried to explain his position on the 1965 Civil Rights Act. But Paul's problem didn't start with the MSNBC host. He made his take perfectly clear in several interviews before that. He said he opposed racism and that government should not practice any sort of discrimination. But he repeatedly drew the line at private businesses. He's leery of the government stepping in and interfering. It was on that point that Rachel Maddow pushed him. To Time, this amounted to some kind of unfair attack on Paul. For Maddow and other liberals, it was a chance to tar him as another Southern politician dog-whistling to angry whites. That's an extraordinarily unfair characterization of what happened on that MSNBC interview. Rachel Maddow asked him some difficult questions, and Rand Paul had trouble answering them. Since then, Paul has attempted to try to redefine his position on civil rights. Time magazine is trying to give him some help. And finally, there's a long history of government officials trying to make sure that the world doesn't hear any more from Mumia Abu-Jamal. After spending years on death row, he's serving a life sentence now for the murder of police officer Daniel Faulkner. His case has drawn international attention, of course, and he continues to write and speak from prison. But a new state law, which seems to obviously violate the First Amendment, seeks to silence him and others behind bars. Abu-Jamal was asked to record a commencement address for Goddard College in Vermont. Pennsylvania lawmakers didn't like that, so they wrote a bill called the Revictimization Relief Act. As one newspaper put it, it would allow the victim of a crime or prosecutors acting on the victim's behalf to bring a civil action to stop an offender from engaging in conduct that causes the victim or the victim's family severe mental anguish. Now, it's not hard to see the threat to free speech here. Democracy Now! Covered the story, but it's attracted very little attention from the rest of the media, despite the profound implications for free speech. The New York Times actually ran this headline, which misses the point in a big way. Media outlets that rely on the First Amendment, that would be all of them, should be speaking up on this. I'm Peter Hart. Thanks for tuning in to Fair TV.